So, if you'd like to make something like this into something like this, then don't let a shortage of this stand in your way. So I've been asked, what kind of tools and workspace does a beginner need to start making longbows like this? The bows I make are loosely based upon the medieval English longbow. That is a self bow made from one stave of wood. It has no handle, no ornamentation, sometimes horn knocks at the tips, sometimes not. It's about the most iconic and perhaps arguably the most beautiful type of bow that you can make. And if you want to make a longbow, please don't be put off by the idea that the tools will be really expensive. I began making bows with a toolkit that cost me less than £80, around $100. Nearly all the bows I've ever made have been made from a stave of wood that I harvested myself. So let's start there. What tools do I use to harvest and prepare a bow stave? If I'm taking down a big tree, obviously I have to use a chainsaw. But if you're a beginner, you're no need to go to that expense. One of these will do just fine. It's a folding saw, readily available from bushcraft outlets, camping stores, Amazon and eBay. It costs very few pounds. And if you think it's not going to be big enough for the job, well, it will easily take down limbs like this. This is a piece of hazel. And from this piece, I'd easily get a bow of 70 to 80 pound draw weight. Now, when you're starting out bow making, there really is no need for a second saw. But I've got one of these as well. Cheap, from a DIY shop, and it's great for trimming up the staves before you start work on them. The next stage of the bow making process is the shaping of the stave. And I like to use one of these. It's a machete made by Gerber. It's easy to keep sharp and clean and works brilliantly on green wood as well as dry wood. About a third of the price of that machete, though, is a hand axe, and that works just as well to shape a stave, ready for making a bow. So those are the tools I use for the initial harvesting and shaping of all my bow staves. In fact, with just an axe, you could make a perfectly good survival bow. But I like to carry on from that point to make a fully finished bow. So what tools do I use next? Now, one of the next tools I put my hands on is one of these. It's a draw knife, great for removing bark and for detailed shaping that perhaps can't be done with an axe or a machete. They come in all sorts of different shapes and sizes. Have a look on eBay, you'd be surprised how many are for sale. And sometimes the vintage ones are best. I also use one of these occasionally. It's a splitting knife made by Mora, and it could be used as a draw knife for detailed work. It's really rather nice. Now, if I'm working on a nice straight stave, there is, in my opinion, no finer piece of kit than one of these. It's a spoke shave. This one's a fairly modern one with a metal body, but if you can pick up a vintage one with a wooden body, do so. They're fantastic, really useful, very efficient, almost an essential piece of kit, I think, for a beginner bowyer. Another really useful woodworking tool, though perhaps not essential for a beginner, is one of these. This is a block plane. Not too expensive, readily available once again. Amazon, eBay, local tool supplier should be able to get you one. Really useful if you're working on a flat-bellied bow. Stage of making a bow, the single most useful tool for me is one of these. It's a wood rasp. It's coarse this side and smooth this side. One side for removing large amounts of wood, and the other side for finishing it. If you're going to spend a little bit of money on a tool, make it one of these. Get a good one. This one is made by BACHO, available on eBay and Amazon, and it's invaluable. It's my favourite piece of kit. Of course, there are other makes and styles of rasp. Look at this one. This is a farrier's rasp. Once again, smoother one side, coarser the other. Great for removing large amounts of wood. And this one, a half round rasp. Look at the shape. One side is curved, the other is flat. This one can be used for working around knots and into strange, difficult corners. During the early stages of making a self-bow, I have to cut temporary knocks in the tips of the bow, and to do that, I use one of these. It's a tile saw. Not absolutely essential, but really useful and inexpensive as well. Okay, let's have a quick recap as to where we've got to. Using the tools that I've just shown you, I can harvest a stave and fashion it into an almost finished longbow, rather like this one. This is a 40-pound ash longbow, made with the tools that I've just shown you. Okay, so the tools that I use next are those that finish the bow, create that lovely smooth appearance and give it the finishing touches. The last tool that I used on this bow was a rasp, and rasps can leave rather deep marks in the wood which need to be removed before the final finishing can take place. And to do that, I invariably use one of these. It's a cabinet scraper, which is no more than a flat piece of metal with a burr along one edge. But don't worry if you haven't got a cabinet scraper. You can use a knife, or in this case, the draw knife, but the blade is held vertically. Of course, there's lots of tools used in bow making that you can improvise or make yourself. One of the simplest is this. It's simply a sanding block, a piece of wood with some sandpaper wrapped around it and secured with either some clips like this or an elastic band. It's a very useful piece of kit. And one of the final things I use in finishing a bow. So that's a roundup of the tools that I use when I'm making a self-knocked longbow. Of course, there are many other useful little pieces of kit, aids if you like, that are really handy when you're making a bow. An aid is something that just makes the job that little bit easier. It can be a jig, it can be a vise, it can be something you've made to help you along doing the job. So let's have a look at the aids that I use when I'm making a longbow. I've been able to find many aids to bow making in the home and the garden shed. Really useful is some means of measuring and marking. I use a tape rule and just a pencil. Occasionally, I'll use one of these, a steel rule. Again, not essential, but if you can get one, really useful. By no means essential, but handy if you can get one, a vernier gauge, or indeed carpenter's calipers. Really useful for measuring the depth and the width of your bow and working out the tapers. If I want to fit horn nocks to the tips of a longbow, sometimes I use these. These are pre-drilled buffalo horn nocks. But when I want to drill them myself, I use a pistol drill and a 12mm tapered bit. I really don't like using power tools when I'm making a self-bow, but I have to say, because I've got one of these, One of these is really handy for me. It's a buffing wheel and can be used to put a high polish on the horn nocks of a longbow. The principal aid to tillering a bow is a tillering stick or a tillering tree. And this is something that you can make at home from scrap materials. That's what I did. This is my first tillering stick. It's just a scrap piece of wood with inch space grooves all the way along there for slotting in the string, and a cradle at the top with a bit of an old glove to make sure the bow is not damaged in any way. I drilled holes here and here through this tillering stick, enabling me to tie it to a post or a tree. And since this one, I've built another sturdier tillering post, which is here. When I'm tillering a bow, I do like to know the bow's draw weight. When I started out, I first use one of these. It's a simple spring balance that will weigh up to 200 pounds. Since then, I've invested in one of these, also a 200 pound scale, but rather more accurate than this one. The cord which runs from the bottom of the scale out to me travels via a pulley, which is attached to the bottom of the tillering tree. And the cord itself in the UK is called sash cord. If you've got access to a bench, then one of these things, a bench vise, will come in really handy when you're making your bows. But again, it's not essential. I've made several bows without the aid of a vise. And talking about benches and vises reminds me we need to talk about workspace. As a beginner bowyer, do you really need a wisteria covered shed in which to make bows? The fact is, you don't. I've made and enjoyed making several bows in open woodland. But of course, there's no denying that having some kind of covered workspace is really beneficial when you're making bows. You've got a place in which to store your tools. And of course, you can work in all weathers. But in reality, my covered workspace is very small. The shed is 6 foot deep by 8 foot wide. My workbench is 2 foot by 4 foot, and I actually work standing in 4 square feet. That's all. The truth is, my covered workspace isn't sufficiently large to allow me to build a longbow undercover. When I'm working inside, some of the bow is poking outside, and all my tillering is done just here on the lawn. Of course, I need a few other materials to finish my bows. Firstly, bowstrings. I use Fast Flight and Dacron B. Dacron B if the draw weight's light, Fast Flight if it's somewhat heavier. And don't be fooled into thinking that you need an expensive jig to make a bowstring. You don't. You can do it entirely by hand. And the same can be said for serving the bowstring. You can use a little tool like this. I sometimes do, but it's perfectly possible to serve a bowstring entirely by hand. And then, of course, the final finish to the bow. I sometimes use boiled linseed oil to coat the bow with, and at other times, tung oil. They both have a very similar effect and leave a beautiful finish. So those are the tools, aids and workspace that I use as a self-taught bowyer to make my bows. I hope you've seen that for a small outlay of money, a lot of imagination and a little bit of space, you too could make that most iconic of weapons, the English longbow.